So here's my current gaming table. I made this quite a while ago, and it only costs $50 to make. This is 2x material on the ends, and I made a core in here. And this is floor mats, actually. And there's black felt underneath here. But I've decided to make a new one because I want this TV to be embedded in the table. That way I can easily play other games on top of it without needing to remove the TV each time that I want to use the tabletop. And so this is my attempt to build a new table without spending a lot more money. So first things first, in terms of tools that you're gonna need, a miter saw will be super handy in terms of making those 45 degree cuts for most of the wood that you're gonna be using. You can use a miter box with a handsaw, but that will take a pretty long time. So just borrow any of your friends who are handy or have tools, they should have one of these. Also, I'll be using a circular saw primarily to cut sheeting as well as cutting out the insert for the TV in the middle of the plywood. And then one handy thing that I love is my air nailer. This is the compressor. That will help just put the thing together really quickly and also have small, very small holes for nails that I can patch in pretty easily. So you don't have to have an air nailer. You can use screws or just traditional hammer and finish nails, but having one of these, again, is gonna make it a lot faster. So I went to Lowe's and I bought all of my wood. And the first thing that I'm gonna do, according to the plans, one adjustment I needed to make is that the plywood is actually a quarter inch smaller, both length and width. That's just the standard cut for 4 foot by 4 foot. And so I'll need to make some adjustments with that. If you did want to get a pure 4 foot by 4 foot, you'll need to get a whole sheet, an 8 foot by 4 foot sheet cut. And then you can have exact measurements, but for my case, I don't really care that I'm losing a quarter inch off of the side. So this is the sheet that I bought relatively cheap for $20. I was able to get this. It's not the greatest grade, but it's pretty cheap. And since I'm covering the tabletop anyway, it didn't matter to me that I had a really good finish. So the first step that I'm gonna make actually will be to cut the hole in the middle of the plywood where the TV will go into. And I'll actually use the frame that I already have downstairs to just pencil that out so that it will fit in there perfectly. So basically I took the frame, which was purely decorative for the TV downstairs, and I centered it onto the plywood and drew, traced around it. So this is the cutout that I'm gonna have, and we'll use the circular saw for that. Now that most of the cutout has been made with the circular saw, I use a jigsaw to finish off the corners. You can overcut with the circular saw to skip this step, or if you don't have a circular saw, you can use a jigsaw to cut out the insert, but I like using the circular saw first because it gives me a straighter edge.
insert taken out. Now that I have the frame established, I'm going to go ahead and work on the legs and the support that goes underneath the board by cutting the 2x4s. So after measuring each piece carefully and framing it out, I'm going to go ahead and just use 2.5-inch screws to put this 2x4 frame together. I pre-drill the holes because it's pretty hard to put in 2.5-inch screws without drilling holes. Repeat that all the way around. Now that I have the 2x4 frame connected to one another, I just need to affix this board onto the frame, and I'm going to go ahead and do that just by drilling underneath and putting in some screws, and then I'll flip the whole thing over and use 1 5/8-inch screws to attach the board onto the frame. Again, I'm pre-drilling holes. Actually, before I flip it over to put the remaining screws onto the frame, I am actually going to need to make this inset rise up a little bit so that it matches the covering for the table. I'll show you later a picture of what I mean by that. And so how I'm going to do that is, this is what I'm using, these foam sheets, and I think they're 5mm thick. An easy way, rather than measuring it out, is just to slide this underneath. And then push down the inside frame so that it has the gap that I need for the thickness of this. And what I'll do is now just screw this in into my 2x4 material. We're gonna go ahead and flip this over, see how well I did. Go ahead and screw down some more screws to attach it to the 2x4s. So this is what I meant by needing to raise this frame that frames out the TV. Just a little bit, the width of my surface. And so as you can see, it'll fit right in there really nicely and remain flush with the top of this frame. So one thing I forgot to do while this was upside down is to put in the supports, cross beams for the TV to rest on. So I'll go ahead and do that now. So I went ahead and installed the crossbeams for the TV support, and the way that my TV was, I wanted it to sink down a little bit lower, so I had to put in these spacers right here so that the TV would be relatively flush with the top of the frame here. So I measured that out, and hopefully the TV will be the right depth. Now I'm going to take steps to create the legs and the bottom support. So I cut all of my legs, and now I'm just going to put 3 screws on these to put them together. You can buy 4x4s, but it's a lot more expensive to do that, so I go the cheap route and just get 2x4s and just put them together, and basically you get the same amount of stability by doing that. And here, I don't really drill because and that is one leg, and we'll go right here. What I'll do is drill some holes because I'm going to be using lag bolts to connect these together. You could potentially use instead of lag bolts where you're screwing in, if you're going to be moving a lot or wanting to be able to take it apart and put it back together, you could just use bolts with nuts on the other side. But since I don't think I'll really be moving this a whole lot, I'll go ahead and just drill and put in lag bolts. And I can't put it together out here because I won't be able to fit it through my door and take it downstairs. So I'll wait to assemble that once I get it downstairs. So the next step is to go ahead and start framing around the edge. I've flipped the top back over so it's right side up, and then we'll start cutting the pieces for the edges. So I cut out the pieces for the border, the inside border, and now I'm marking 2.5 inches because that's the height that I want for the drop down of the table. So just go ahead and mark 2.5 inches so that I know where to nail this into the sides. And then what I'll do is I'll put line of glue on the edge and use my air nailer to hold it in place, and then I can go ahead and screw it in. Once you have some nails to hold it in place, I'm going to go ahead and put screws in because it'll be a lot stronger and hold it into place. I was going to actually use this wood as cross supports like this, but I figured that actually the place that people are going to be leaning on the most is actually going to be this edge. And so decided to use the 2x4s instead, as that would I would be able to secure it a lot more onto this edge so that when people are sort of leaning against it, there's more support. The reason why I notched these pieces, see how I cut right across here, is because I'm going to be doing cutouts of the top, and so I can't have these support pieces going all the way up to the top here, so I need a gap that's right here. So go ahead and use an air nailer, put one nail in there, and then I'll use this, stick one screw. There. That's really secure, and I'll do that. So here's an example of what happens when you don't pre-drill the holes. As you can see, this screw here cracked this whole line of wood, and that's because I didn't pre-drill, and so when the fat part of the screw went in, it basically cracked this whole thing. So I went ahead to make sure and pre-drilled the other holes, but this won't be too big of a problem because the trim will actually make that so that you can't see that section. But just a tip, make sure to pre-drill your holes, especially when you're towards the end of a board like this, because it has a greater chance of cracking. So here we have pretty much all of the supports in place and screwed in. And so next we're going to go ahead and put the side boards in along the edges here. So I'm needing to cut these at an angle. So as you can see, my miter saw can cut at a 45 degree angle. So after measuring out, creates a 45 degree connection. So I'm doing that to all the corners. Now, before I can attach this here like it's supposed to, I need to actually first cut out a hole here because I'm gonna put in outlets that I need to install. So in order for this to go in here, I need to cut out this hole first on all four sides. Now with the holes cut out for the outlets, I can go ahead and glue and nail these in. So these holes are small enough that I will be able to fill them in with wood putty later. As you can see, my saw is too short and won't cut all the way through, but that's a pretty easy fix. You can just turn it around to finish the cut. These top pieces are 5.5 inches wide, and now that I've cut all of them, I just need to cut the holes for the cup holders, and then I'm gonna notch out just a space to put dice and pencils and other things like that. So I'll do that to each one of these boards before nailing them down. It's still flipped over upside down, and what I'm doing is attaching this tag board on there so that I have a bottom for the dice bin. So just flip that over. Now I can glue and nail these. The last last little bit before sanding is putting this corner around along this outside, and that is so that later when I create a tabletop insert that goes in on top and is flush with this, this will actually catch it. All right, so today I went and got more wood after finishing up most of the tabletop. It took me a while to figure out how I wanted to do this top because most of the options that I was looking at, either using plywood or flooring, already pre-finished flooring, cost quite a bit. So even a nice piece of plywood that's a better grade than this one was probably going to cost, I'd have to get a whole 4-foot by 8-foot sheet for $50, and I didn't want to spend that much. So the best option that I came up with was actually these 4-foot by, I think they're 12-foot boards, but actual size is a little bit more than 11 inches. And so I got four of them, and I think I got four boards for about $16, so that ended up being the cheapest and the nicest option. As you can tell though, the width is actually a little bit shorter than 4 feet, and so I'm gonna have to trim this edge because along this side it gets a little bit narrower enough that these won't fit in there. So I'll just take the circular saw and just trim out all of the boards so that all of them can fit on this end. Oh, another thing that I did is use this wood filler, and you can use pretty much any kind of wood filler, but I wanted to make sure that I could stain the wood filler. So this is just one. There's a lot of different types. They all do the same job. And basically what I did was I just used a putty knife and went in and filled it in here. So this is the air nailer hole without the putty, and this is with it. And then I'll go back and sand it down once I'm done sanding. So this is the rest of the wood. There's the bottom supports, the legs, as well as a shelf that I'm building along the bottom. And so hopefully I will get all of the cutting done today, and we'll be able to put together all those pieces, and then hopefully be able to sand and start finishing in the next day or two. So I don't have my tripod with me, so I can't set up to show you while I'm at work, but hopefully through the other videos you can get a sense of how to cut boards, and I will show you how to sand once I am at that stage. One thing I did want to share is this morning at my doorstep, I was totally surprised to see this box arrive. For those of you who don't know, this is Kingdom Death Monster. Probably the most anticipated game that I've ever pre-ordered. I actually didn't kickstart, unfortunately, but I've been so excited, and it's a little bit unfortunate that I'm in the middle of building my table because I totally want to play this game. So that will be all the more reason for me to hurry and finish making the table so that I can actually bust out this game and use on my new table. So here I slapped together the frame for the bottom sort of support for the legs, as well as the shelf that's going to be there where I can store more games. What I did was I bought this 10-foot by 8-inch wide board, and what I'll do now is I need to cut it down to the width of the frame, and I need four of those boards to span that length. So I'm actually cutting through two boards at the same time with my circular saw, and this is a handy dandy guide that will guide the edge of my circular saw, like so. So it gives me a nice clean cut. The board is too wide for my my miter saw here. My miter saw can only handle up to 5-inch wide cuts. So I'm going to go ahead and cut that and then show you what it looks like on there. So this is what it looks like. I was actually mistaken. It was 8-foot boards, not 10-foot boards that I bought, which is good because that's all I really needed. As you can tell, because of the width of the board, there's going to be spaces in between. But again, I don't care because I'm just going to be putting game boxes down here. So it doesn't matter if things fall through there or not. Nothing really should. And since it's going to be down at the bottom, it doesn't really matter. But before I nail those in, I'm going to go ahead and use this platform to trim off the tabletop boards, as I mentioned before. Just slightly, enough for them to fit in the slots up there. Okay, so I finished the bottom platform, and as you can see, I went ahead and actually inserted a 1x3 right in the middle, and that got rid of all of the gaps. So the 10-inch wide boards fit perfectly along this bottom. So this is gonna be the bottom support piece. You'll notice that I didn't screw in this last board all the way because you're gonna need to remove that piece in order to attach the bottom piece to the legs once you're done assembling the whole table. So I didn't bother to put in the last screws. I'm just using those to hold it in place while I sand, and will stain that bottom piece with everything else. And then up here, I finished trimming out the 4-foot long boards. I took maybe 1/8 of an inch off so that it would fit all the way across. And as well here, a 1x3 piece right in the middle. I drilled a hole so I could lift this piece out really easily. Otherwise it'd be very hard taking these pieces out. But this 1x3 fits just perfectly. Just the right amount of width, which was serendipitous for me. And then you can lift these boards out. So I'm super happy with that. A $16 solution as opposed to a $50 solution. And I think it looks really nice. The pieces do have a little bit of warpage on them. And probably as it dries out, it might move a little bit more, but I don't mind it being a little bit uneven. It doesn't really matter since a board game will probably just lay flat on there anyway, so it doesn't really matter. So I'm happy with that. So since all of my cutting is done, I will now proceed to fill in all of the holes with putty, wood putty again, and then we'll start sanding. I have a orbital sander, finish sander with 180 and then 220 grit sandpaper, so that'll give me a nice smooth finish, and then I will be able to stain after that. All right, so I just got done sanding most of the table, and what I used was a little orbital palm sander. Obviously, you can do it by hand, but these make it super fast. I have it hooked up to my shop vac so that dust isn't flying everywhere. And basically used 220 grit, which is pretty fine. And so it's very smooth now because of that. And next step will be putting on the stain. So this has been all prep work for staining, and there's sort of three steps to that. The first is to pre-stain, and what this does is it basically conditions the wood so that the stain goes on evenly. If you don't use this stuff, especially for soft woods like pine, I found that the stain really goes on sort of splotchy. And so the pre-stain, the wood conditioner, really helps the stain go on more smoothly. So after I put this stuff on, then I will put the stain that I chose. I like this deeper, darker red chestnut color from Minwax. Obviously you can use any that you want. And then the final will be putting on 3 coats of polyurethane. And I chose a semi-gloss finish rather than the high gloss. Just because that's the finish that I prefer. So I'm going to go ahead and just put this conditioner on. And basically,
this is clear, so when you put it on, it just looks like you're putting water on your wood. But again, it's mostly just for prep work, so you can be sloppy with that. But this is the stuff that, depending on how dark the wood turns out, because pine tends to be lighter than other woods when you stain it, usually you have to do two coats, but I'll see after I do one coat of this whether or not I need to do a second coat. But I'm going to go ahead and stain and then show you the results of that.
All right, so I got done staining the table last night, and it only needed one coat. As you can see, it's pretty dark. I have the other pieces out here drying. I stained the opposite side, the bottom side of the boards that go on top this morning to let it dry, the other side dry a little bit before I flipped it over. So now, as you can see, it looks pretty nice, but I'm going to put on the first coat of polyurethane. And so this will be a three-layer process, and I think it takes about 4 hours in between coats. So I'll probably be able to get two coats done today and then the last coat done tomorrow. So here's a table. I had some friends last night help me bring it downstairs, and it's still sitting on one of my fold-out tables as I'll be attaching the legs to it soon. But I wanted to show you the finish on it. The stain turned out really nice. I'm glad that I only had to do one coat. And I did three coats of polyurethane, and this is semi-gloss. And these are all the cup holders that are in there. And I'm in process right now. Oh, the TVs are also in there. I need to raise it just a little bit because the gap, it's sunk down a little bit too far. So I'm going to put these 5mm foam inserts at the bottom to raise it just a little bit more. I also put foam right along here where the table surface will lay on. I decided to do that just to provide a softer surface for the boards to rest on. You don't have to do that, but I had extra self-stick foam. And let me show you that real quick. So this I got at Hobby Lobby, or you can get it at any Michaels or craft store. I got a couple sheets of this stuff, but mostly I got this 5mm thick stuff. And that's what's lining all of this portion here. Just measured it out and cut it so that fits into place. I didn't buy enough, so I have to go back to the store and fit those two last spots there. And this tabletop will be complete. You can do any kind of surface for this. You can use actually vinyl self-stick tiles. You can actually keep it wood and finish that out as wood. You can even use carpet squares if you wanted to. I actually discourage people from using felt, or at least low quality black felt. That's what I had on my old table, and it would just get too nappy. I wasn't able to clean it or vacuum it up very well. And so I prefer actually something a little bit easier to clean, because gamers tend to get crumbs and all that kinds of stuff on there. So I want to be able to vacuum it up pretty easily. I also lined the inside of these with the really thin foam. I just cut it out, and I don't even need to glue it in there. Again, if something spills down in there, I want to be able to remove it and be able to clean it. I'm wondering whether or not to line the sides of these. At this point, as you can tell, there are imperfections. For example, where I cut the corners. And that's how the jigsaw works in terms of how you navigate a corner. And so it's not perfectly even, but it might be good enough for me where I don't want to go through the work of just lining all of the sides with more foam. I don't think it needs it, but maybe later on I might change my mind and go ahead and do that. One of the things too that I wanted to mention, although I didn't get it on video, is when you are staining, if you've never stained before, it's relatively easy. I have two sets of brushes that I use. This is basically a throwaway brush, one-time use.
I think it's like $1.25 for a 2-inch brush at Lowe's or Home Depot. And I used this brush basically to put on all the stain, and you basically apply the stain going with the grain, a pretty generous amount. And then I would go on to the next section and go ahead and stain that, and letting the excess sort of sit on the wood so that it soaks in. And then after I was done with that other section, I would come back and basically I use paper towels and just wipe off the excess, and you're left with a nice smooth finish like this. And with the polyurethane, I bought these. I think this was $8 for 3 of them, and I only ended up using 1. I wanted a bigger brush because I wanted to be able to hold more of the polyurethane on the brush. And same thing, just brush it on. And the key thing about it is in between each coat after it dries, you need to sand it lightly, very lightly, with 220 grit sandpaper. And that basically gives it a surface for the next layer to adhere to. And also to get rid of some of the bumps or little imperfections that are there. So I did 3 coats of polyurethane. Clearly you don't have to stain it. You can save some money if you don't want to spend the money buying a stain and just keep it natural wood. For me, because all of my pine and all of the wood were different colors from one another, they were different shades, I chose to have a somewhat darker stain so that it would make all of the wood one uniform color. But again, you can save probably about $12 to $15 on stain if you just go with the natural wood. I would highly suggest, though, that you do at least put polyurethane on there, and that will just give you a nice finish that will protect the wood. So if someone spills something, it won't actually stain the wood, and you can just wipe it up pretty easily.
Sorry that the lighting is dark, but we are under the table. And so basically I took one of my legs and grabbed my 2.5-inch 5/16 lag bolt, put on the washer, and basically am feeding it through the leg first. So you're going to do that to all 4 sides. While we're down here, one of the things I want to mention that I wish I would have done before attaching the support 2x4 here is I wish I would have cut an angle like right here, like this, for the main reason that people's knees will be bumping against this support. All right, so I have all 4 feet in, and I put 2x4 on edge. So that I could pull the table out from underneath it, the supporting table. And I'm actually going to keep them on those blocks because I messed up on one of my pieces here. And this is the bottom shelf supporting piece. The primary reason why I made this piece is actually I was worried that these legs would need cross pieces along the bottom for greater support. But after putting these on and using these lag bolts, these are actually really strong. And so you can skip this step. I don't think the table actually needs those cross pieces on the legs to support them because these are on pretty firmly. But I'm going to go ahead and use this since I went ahead and made it. But you can save probably about $30, $40 if you don't end up making this bottom part. But the way that I messed up is I intentionally left this board here unscrewed, but for some reason I covered up this screw head with wood putty, and I should have left that out because my intention was to completely remove this board so that I would be able to set this piece in and then just screw in through the top and then put this board back on. But because I managed to cover that up and I didn't want to ruin the board by drilling back in, I went ahead and just screwed this top piece on permanently. And I'm going to rest the thing on these blocks and have to go in underneath. So it's a lot harder to do it that way. So make sure
that if you are putting in this bottom shelf, to go ahead and don't screw in those two end boards so that you have access to screwing them in a lot easier.
So this is what I mean by making life a lot harder. So instead of being able to go through the top here by having this board, now I've had to support the whole thing and do it all by feel rather than by sight. But fortunately, it seems to be working. I can get a feel for where the screw is. There it goes. There. So looks like it's attaching all right.
All right, so there you have it. I took the supports out and I think it looks pretty awesome. And even though you don't really need this bottom shelf to support the legs, this thing is now rock solid. Now look at this thing. I'm trying to move it and it barely move. So even if someone bumps against the table, it's not going to knock over all the pieces or shift the pieces on the board. And so that thing is super solid.
Okay, some things about wiring. So if you have never wired before, well, first of all, clearly putting it in outlets into your table is completely optional. And again, you'll save probably $15 if you don't wire your table. The reason why I'm doing it is more and more my gaming friends have iPads or even using their smartphones to look up rules or whatnot. And so this is a way for people to be plugged in. A lot of my rules I like to be PDFs so that I can look or do search functions to look up rules. So. Increasingly, I think more and more games are using electronics as player aids, and so that's why I'm installing it. And it is relatively cheap, but if you don't know what you're doing, you definitely don't want to wire things incorrectly and potentially cause a fire. But wiring is actually much easier than most people know, especially when you're working with something very simple like just basically these outlets. There's three wires that go in. This is the neutral, which is the green, or the ground wire. The ground wire, which has no, it's a bare copper wire. And then the white is where the neutral wire goes in, and then the copper is where the black wire goes in. It's what powers it up. A lot of these have convenient plug-in holes. You don't actually even need to use these screws. And so I'll just be plugging the wires directly in the back of these. And so I actually got five. So I got the black ones for the sides, four along each side. And then I just got this white one since it's cheaper, basically for the bottom, because I want the TV to be able to plug in and I don't want to plug it in on the side. And so I will go ahead and wire. And if you're wondering what tools you need to use, basically you need wire cutters. You'll need a knife to strip off the outer sheathing, and these are wire strippers. And that's pretty much it. I do have, because I do quite a bit of wiring anyway, I do have these cable staples, and I'll be using these, but clearly you don't need to buy this many. You can buy small packages of them, but this is all material that I've already had. And finally, a word about the wiring. I have a huge roll, 250 feet of it, again, because I do quite a bit of wiring anyway. But I think for this project, you would only need either 15 or 25 feet, depending on how many wires or how many outlets that you're gonna have. I'll try to keep track. All right, so the first step is I grab my box where the outlet is gonna go in. I probably could have gotten a standard size, but I got a lower profile box for all the electrical to go into for the first thing, for the first plug. And I also got this appliance plug, and this is what's gonna plug into the wall and power the whole thing. So I stuck one end in here, and you can take off these covers. And typically you wanna pigtail these
rather than going directly into the plug, but because again I have a low profile box and I don't have a ton of space to work with, I'm just going to go directly onto here. Now I also need the wire out, and so this is where my 14-2 Romex comes into play. This is what's going to go to the next plug. So this also needs to come in to the box like this. And basically you want to take your knife and cut down the sheathing like that. That exposes three wires, and that's what the 14-2 means, is that it's 14 gauge wire and that there is two main wires, the black and the white. And then here's your ground, the copper is your ground wire. And then you want to strip these ends enough so that it will poke into the outlet. There. And I'm going to actually use the side screws, since these wires are braided, and then I'll show you what it looks like after I'm done. So I went ahead and put the wires on. Now technically you're not supposed to have two wires underneath one bolt, but again, I'm wiring low voltage table, it's not going to be that big a deal. And I wired both the black wire here with the copper, the neutral wire here with the silver screw. And then what I do with these two is on the back, you have these holes. You could put them under the screw, that's fine. And some people just prefer to do that, but you know, I will go ahead and just stick in this wire in the back, and then this wire in the back of the black side there. And then now that all of that is wired together, I can go ahead and screw this down in the, or actually before I screw this down in the box, I'm gonna go ahead and attach it to the table. So there it is attached underneath on the support beam, tucked away so that the TV can plug in there. And I have the plug coming out. I went ahead and put in two staples to keep the wire on the leg, and that will plug into the wall and power the whole thing. And then I have the Romex coming out and coming to the first outlet. So I'll go ahead and wire that similarly, and then put in a new lead out wire that will go to the next outlet on the other side, and just go around in a circle doing that. All right, I got the electrical wiring done. I'll show you what it looks like underneath. So basically I have that plug plugging into the wall, and then this wire here, and the second wire coming out of that and going over here, and basically goes all the way around. since they don't have a box, I did use electrical tape just to tape off any open terminals so that anyone reaching underneath there won't get shocked. And that should pretty much work well. And here's my little tester, just to check, make sure, and sure enough, all of the wiring is good. So I didn't mix up the ground wire or the neutral wire or anything like that. So that is good. I also got the last bit of foam and was able to finish that off, so that looks super nice. And I wanted to show you actually this. I ordered this off of Amazon. I think it was $12. I'm not sure. You can look at my parts list
and see how much this was. So pretty cheap for two of them, so I'll go ahead and mount that.